Unlike Katharina Zell or Agula von Grumbach, Wieberandus Rosenblatt did not publicly weigh in on the doctrinal disputes of the reformers with her own theological opinions. Nevertheless, with her actions and practices, she actively participated in the current affairs of her time. Wieberandus Rosenblatt and Katharina Zell had one thing in common. They were among the first women to work alongside their clergy husbands. After a brief first marriage, Wieberandus would become the wife of no less than three prominent reformers, Johannes Ico Lampadius, Wolfgang Capito, and Martin Bucer. And as a mother of 11 children, she certainly looked back on an eventful life.
In 1504, Wieberandus was born to Magdalena Strub and Hans Rosenblatt in the rural town of Seckingen. When her mother took the healthy newborn baby girl in her arms, she said,
"We will name her Wieberandus after one of the three venerated virgins who have just been canonized. The name shall be a blessing for my daughter."
Little is known of Hans Rosenblatt, her father. In 1510, he was the incumbent mayor of Seckingen. However, as an imperial field captain in military service for the Archduke of Austria, he was not around when Wieberandus was born. It was probably due to her husband's prolonged absence that Wieberandus' mother eventually returned to her native Basel with her and her older brother Adalbert. At the age of 20, Wieberandus married for the first time, only to be widowed a mere 2 years later.
In those years, pastor, reformer and university professor Johannes Ecolopadius from Basel decided to get married when his mother, who had done the housework for him, passed away. Young Wieberandus was to become his spouse. She met Ico Lampadius, who was more than 22 years her senior, when he was the vicar at St. Martin's in Basel. In 1528, he married Wieberandus, who was an ardent follower of the new doctrine. He was one of the last reformers to enter into marriage, prompted by his friend Martin Bucer from Strasbourg, who had already married Katharina Schütz and Lutheran pastor Matthew Zell at Strasbourg Cathedral 5 years before. The marriage between well-known preacher and scholar Johannes Ico Lampadius and this young woman invited a lot of caustic criticism, not least by Erasmus of Rotterdam, the eminent humanist who lived in Basel at the time. However, young Wieberandus soon gained respect, and Ico Lampadius praised for her personal maturity and true piety. She would bear him three children, but during her third pregnancy in 1531, the reformer died, and Wieberandus became a widow again.
At the same time, the wife of preacher Wolfgang Capito from the circle of Strasbourg's reformers succumbed to the plague. The Upper Rhine region was a small world, and Wieberandus was quickly married to Capito, once again mediated by Martin Bucer, who had urged his fellow reformer to remarry as soon as possible. This third marriage was blessed with five children. Supported by her mother, Wieberandus kept a large household at the parsonage in Strasbourg, which was frequented by numerous guests, religious refugees, and other people seeking help, including amicable reformers such as Huldrych Zwingli.
When Strasbourg was hit by another plague epidemic in 1541, Wieberandus lost three children and her third husband within a few days. Across Strasbourg, 3,200 people fell victim to the Black Death. Reformer and matchmaker Martin Bucer also lost his wife Elizabeth Silbereisen and five children. On her deathbed, Elizabeth urged Wieberandus to take care of her family and marry Martin. This marriage, her fourth, proved to be happier and less burdened than the one with Capito, who had suffered from depression and financial difficulties.
However, circumstances beyond their control soon dictated life at the parsonage. 1546 marked the beginning of the Schmalkaldic War between the forces of Emperor Charles V and the Schmalkaldic League, a defensive alliance of Lutheran princes and cities established in 1531 under the leadership of Saxony and Hesse. The war was an attempt by Charles V to repress the Protestant religion within the Holy Roman Empire and strengthen his imperial power over the princes. By 1547, the emperor's campaign was successful, and the Schmalkaldic League was dissolved.
In the course of these events, the Papists began to reassess themselves in Strasbourg, and in 1548, Martin Bucer was forced to leave the city because of his refusal to accept an imperial decree on the re-adoption of Catholic beliefs and practices. He was offered sanctuary and a professorship in Cambridge. However, the separation from his family and the English climate affected him greatly, so that he asked Vibrandus and their children to join him. The journey to Cambridge lasted 8 days at the time. Martin Bucer continued to help establish the Anglican Church for another 2 years before he succumbed to a serious illness in 1551. Fortunately, he had the foresight to appoint Vibrandus as his heiress. Widowed yet again, she returned to Strasbourg and prevented the confiscation of Bucer's possessions. In 1553, the widely respected widow moved to her hometown of Basel, where she died from the plague in 1564. She was interred in the grave of Ico Lampadius in the cloisters of the Basel Minster. Her selfless devotion allowed her husbands to dedicate themselves completely to the cause of the Reformation and to the establishment of an evangelical church. Johannes Ico Lampadius had praised the successful and loving relationship with his young wife and wrote,
"And then I was urged to marry this girl, a commoner, the daughter of a relatively well-to-do civil servant. In her, I have found a very pure and honest helper who is extremely devoted to our Lord and who willingly hosts and looks after our guests and gives alms. Verily, compared to her virtuousness, I find myself lacking in virtue as her husband."
In her profession as evangelical clergy spouse, Vibrandus was a pioneer. A letter written by Pietro Vamili, a theologian and reformer who was forced to flee from Italy and became professor in Strasbourg after travelling through Switzerland in 1542, provides some insight into the pious life in Martin Bucer's household, although Vibrandus herself is not mentioned explicitly.
17 days I stayed with him, in which time I spied wonderful examples of godliness, as well as in his doctrine, as in his life. His house seemed to be a house of hospitality. At his table there is godly moderation. Before and after meat, somewhat is recited out of the Holy Scriptures, which might minister for godly and holy communications.
Impressing her contemporaries with her wide-ranging social action, lively intellectual exchange and solidarity with the persecuted, Vibrandus Rosenblatt was a champion for the Christian hospitality and commiserated with the destitute condition of the less fortunate.